That will be, we'll see. Good morning, everybody. 8 o'clock is a little bit early for most of you and for me on Saturday morning, but I hope it's worthwhile to be here and to listen to my presentation. And I hope I can persuade you that EKG monitoring after ischemic stroke or TIA of unknown source, ESUS, with an insertable monitor is necessary. Well, you all know that the problem of ischemic stroke, and in, especially in patients with atrial fibrillation, is huge. And ischemic stroke can be due to different causes, and we heard a lot about it. And there are two, the embolic, the major risk source of cardiac embolism, but 25% is due to an embolic stroke of unknown source. And that might well be associated, and I told you yesterday, we had a discussion yesterday, whether atrial fibrillation is a mechanism or just a bystander, but it may well be associated with atrial fibrillation. And what is in the guidelines now is that it is only indicated in patients with an embolic stroke of unknown source to monitor them for only 24 hours. Well, and that is only 24 hours, but detection of atrial fibrillation in these patients, and note that these patients are secondary prevention patients, not primary, but secondary prevention patients. They already suffered from a stroke, and therefore, when you discover atrial fibrillation, when you see it on an EKG, it has important therapeutic implications. Well, what are the data at the moment? Let me first show you data in high-risk patients. This is a recently published paper by Jeff Healy, the ASSERT-2. He included patients of an age of 65 years, either at a cardiology or a neurology department, without known clinical or subclinical atrial fibrillation. The patients were included with a CHEDS-VASc of 2 or more, or sleep apnea syndrome, or obesity, or either a left atrial size of more than 44 millimeters, or a left atrial volume above 58, or an increased NT-proBNP. And they looked for, their primary endpoint was subclinical atrial fibrillation, 5 minutes or more. They included 256 patients, elderly, mean age 74 years, with indeed a high risk, CHEDS-VASc, 4, and an enlarged left atrial size, and in their population, about half of them already suffered from a prior stroke. And this is the outcome. In these patients, 90 patients, so one-third of the population, suffered from subclinical atrial fibrillation within 1 year. And you can see that there was a gradual increase during 24 hours, but it increased more and more during follow-up. And if the patient suffered from a prior stroke, it was even higher. So in the population we are interested, about 40% in 1 year and not during that first 24 hours. Predictors, of course, were age, left atrial size, and blood pressure. There's a second trial, the REVEAL-AF. More or less the same, and also it was their goal to determine the incidence of previously undiagnosed clinical or subclinical AF with an implantable loop recorder in a high-risk population, and their primary endpoint was subclinical AF lasting more than 6 minutes, but with a follow-up of 18 months. It was a single-arm, open-label, multicenter study, and they included also high-risk patients with a CHEDS-2 of 2, so that resembles a CHEDS-VASc of 4, or with one of those other additional factors, or a CHEDS-2 of 3. So indeed, high-risk patients. And indeed, the patients, their mean age was 72, so more or less the same. and the chats was 4. And this is what they show. And as you can see, immediately, not only during the first 24 hours, but continuously during follow-up, more and more patients suffer from an episode of subclinical atrial fibrillation. And in their population, the total rate within 18 months was 29%, and during the first month, it was only 6%. So indeed in favor of long-term monitoring, as you can clearly see. So subclinical AF in patients at risk for stroke is high, about 30% per year. And what do the studies in ESUS patients tell us when they are monitored for 24 hours or more? Well, let me start. There are two nice, well-designed randomized trials published both in 2014 in the New England Journal of Medicine. The first one, the EMBRACE AF, included 572 patients aged more than 55 years with a cryptogenic stroke, so ESUS, embolic stroke of unknown origin. No prior atrial fibrillation detected. Those patients were randomized to 30 days of event-triggered monitoring, not continuous loop monitoring, versus a 24-hour hold monitoring alone. Their primary outcome, subclinical atrial fibrillation lasting more than 30 seconds occurring during the first 6 months. And these were all the devices they used, so no implantable loop recorders in the EMBRACE AF. And this was the outcome. And again, you can clearly see, after 1 day, 2%. After 1 week, 7%. And after 1 month, 15% of the patients suffered from subclinical atrial fibrillation. And that is depicted also on this slide, an important difference, 3% in the Holter group versus the 30-day monitoring group, 16%. So the number needed to find subclinical AF, the number of patients is only 8. Cost effective in my view. Well, the final data come from the Crystal AF. 440 patients with an age over 40 years, no prior AF, randomized to either an implantable loop recorder or routine clinical care. Again, the endpoint, AF lasting more than 30 seconds. And this is the outcome. And note that important difference between the two groups, which was highly significant, the detection of subclinical AF was 30% in the implantable loop arm versus only 3% in the control arm. So, and the median time again was 41 days, so not 1 day. You need to monitor these patients longer. So, my conclusion, Mr. and Mrs. Sterman, is that EKG monitoring after an ischemic stroke arrhythmia of unknown source with an insertable monitor indeed is needed. Yes, thank you for your attention.